Hello everyone, welcome back to MI2 series, Machine Intelligence on Modern Infrastructure. My name is Janaki Ram. I am going to be the presenter for this session, and I'm really excited to bring you NVIDIA Jetson Nano. So if you are attending MI2 for the first time, let me set the context. We are currently experiencing the convergence of modern infrastructure and machine intelligence. On one side, we have Kubernetes, containers, microservices gaining a lot of momentum. And on the other side, machine learning, IoT, and artificial intelligence are becoming the most useful workloads for the enterprise, as well as many other businesses. So these workloads, when run on modern infrastructure, deliver utmost value. And my goal is to bring the convergence of modern infrastructure and machine intelligence to you in the form of Kubernetes, service mesh, microservices, when it comes to infrastructure, and edge computing, IoT, ML, AI, cognitive computing on the intelligence front. This is my seventh month, and I have an exciting announcement to make. Google Cloud has come on board as the premium sponsor, and starting this month, I have Google backing this entire initiative, and I'm very excited and very happy, and I'm thankful for Google to come on board as a sponsor. This is going to add momentum, and this is going to bring in additional content, and I can do much more, much bigger things. So that's about MI2. And like all my sessions, this is going to be recorded and will be uploaded to YouTube. It'll also be available on MI2.live. So if you have been following my sessions, the last quarter has been all about edge and AI at edge. I have done couple of sessions on Google Coral DevKit, on Intel Movidius and Myriad chipset. And now I'm very excited to bring you Jetson Nano. And this is a very powerful device or a kit, which is running a GPU. And I've been spending last couple of weeks tinkering with it and getting into the depth of the software and the actual integration with rest of the IoT components like the GPIO and the Raspberry Pi ecosystem. So I'm going to share some of my findings and some of the excitement that I'm currently experiencing with Jetson Nano. This is just the beginning. This is the very first session where I'm going to introduce you to the board. I'm planning to do a couple of deep dive sessions, particularly on optimizing models for Jetpack, TensorRT, and specifically for Jetson Nano, and also performing transfer learning on device at the edge. So this is the very first session, and as most of my sessions are structured, there are going to be a couple of tutorials published at the new stack. One was already up last week, and I'm going to publish one more tomorrow on setting up the software stack, configuring Jetpack, TensorRT, and TensorFlow on Jetson Nano. But before I go any further, let me make sure you're actually able to see my screen and you're able to hear the audio. So let me know if you have difficulty, and I'll try to figure out what's going wrong. But looks like most of you are able to follow the content, which is excellent. So let me close the poll. And I have one more poll just to gauge your interest and your background. Have you ever deployed AI models at edge? I know this is a very interesting, tricky question, because not many are familiar with deploying AI models at edge, but this is becoming one of the destinations and logical home for running ML and AI models. So if you haven't started exploring this, this is going to be the future of AI. AI is going to be predominantly become visible and become more valuable when it comes to edge and becomes offline. So I get a good sense. I think 30% of you are saying yes, which is fantastic. And most of you are not familiar with deploying AI models at edge. That's not a problem. I'm going to walk you through some of the basics. And I'm also going to show you a couple of demos, like most of my sessions. So I never do a session without a demo. So stay tuned for a couple of interesting demos. All right. So what do we have in store? I'm going to start off with a quick overview of GPUs and a quick overview of Jetson Nano. Then we will zoom into the software that actually powers this device. And then we will understand how Nano performs AI inferencing offline and how it is a powerhouse for AI inferencing. And then I'm going to walk you through a few demos that will emphasize on how powerful the device is and what it is capable of. So CPU versus GPU, it's a very common question, and a lot of people discuss why GPU when we have very powerful CPUs. Well, the fundamental difference between CPU and GPU is CPU is a very powerful processor. It is almost like the heart of your computer or a server. It can perform a lot of things, but it is not designed for performing extremely compute or mathematical intensive tasks in parallel. Deep learning, machine learning, and cognitive computing is all about performing matrix multiplications, vector multiplications, and tensor multiplications at a very high scale. And unfortunately, the CPU is not just designed for that. So we have a supporting processor in the form of a GPU that is actually taking over the responsibility of performing these mathematical calculations in parallel. The CPU is still the boss. The GPU is going to be assisting the CPU in just accelerating the mathematical computation, which is very, very important for machine learning, deep learning, and even for other workloads like high-performance computing, genome modeling, video rendering, game design, and so on. Just to give you a sense, the Intel Xeon Platinum comes with 28 cores, whereas the NVIDIA V100 Volta GPU comes with 80 cores, and it can actually perform many more operations per second than the CPU. So that's the reason why GPUs are becoming very, very hot, and they are currently trending in the IT industry because most of the workloads are now exploiting the power of GPUs, and particularly parallel processing and machine learning, analytics. A lot of those workloads are taking advantage of the GPU architecture. So NVIDIA is the leader when it comes to GPUs. They power all the way from laptops to desktops to servers to cloud, and very high niche purpose-built machines that can perform the deep learning training and high performance computing and so on. It is the only company that actually does edge to cloud. So we have the most economical, affordable, small form factor device like the Jetson Nano that is powered by a GPU, and it can go all the way to a DGX box that is one of the most powerful, most expensive GPU powered infrastructure. And many pharmaceutical companies and many large enterprises are investing in DGX for in-house training and high-performance computing workloads. At the same time, mainstream cloud providers like Amazon, Microsoft, Google, IBM, they all have NVIDIA GPU-based VMs. K80, P100, T4 are becoming the de facto GPUs for machine learning and deep learning in the cloud. So it basically spans everything from the edge, which is going to be deployed in industrial environments and very remote locations like turbines and windmills and so on, all the way to the public cloud and enterprise data center. It is exactly the same GPU that powers the whole spectrum. So on one extreme end, we have Jetson Nano, which is the smallest device. And the other extreme end, we have DGX and public cloud providers. What is common in this spectrum is essentially GPU that is powering the compute infrastructure. So that is about NVIDIA's presence across the edge and the cloud. Now, focusing on Jetson Nano, I was very, very excited when Jetson Nano came. I already have a Jetson TX2. It was more expensive, more powerful, and the form factor is slightly higher. It's almost like a PC motherboard, but a Jetson Nano closely resembles the Raspberry Pi form factor, and it is the dream machine for any IoT and AI enthusiast because it is actually an IoT dev kit. It has the GPIO compatible with Raspberry Pi headers, and some of the ecosystem partners like Seed Studio and Adafruit and SparkFun are building libraries that are very specific to Nano. So you can actually treat it like a proper IoT environment, an IoT device. And the beauty of this is it actually comes with a full-blown GPU that has 128 CUDA cores. CUDA is the Compute Unified Device Architecture. It is the fundamental layer that talks to the NVIDIA device driver, which will talk to the GPU. And it, it uses the same layer that is powering rest of the public cloud environments or the enterprise environments. It also comes with a 4-core CPU, an ARM 64 CPU, pretty powerful, 4 GB memory, and performs 472 GFLOP per second. It's powered either at 5-watt or 10-watt, and it just costs $99. It packs a lot of punch for the price. You can do a lot with the Jetson Nano. So it looks quite a bit like most of the system on board devices like BeagleBone, Raspberry Pi, the Acer Tinkerkit, and so on. But this is very different. The fundamental difference is it actually has a GPU on board, which makes it very unique and special and very affordable. So when we look at the dev kit specifications, as I mentioned, it comes with a 64-bit ARM processor. It actually runs the ARC 64 architecture, has a GPU with 128 cores, 4 GB of LPDDR4, the fastest memory, and it has video encoders that can actually deal with 4 cameras on board. You can also connect additional IP cameras for processing the feed. Comes with USB 3 ports. It has compatible camera serial interface, which means you can actually connect a Raspberry Pi camera to Jetson Nano. You can also connect USB cameras like the standard Logitech C270s and rest of the mainstream USB cameras. It has a gigabit Ethernet port, and there's a micro SD slot. And of course, my favorite feature is a 40-pin header that is compatible with Raspberry Pi headers. And there is a fantastic Python library to deal with it, which means you can actually combine AI inferencing with IoT and do a very, very fun, interesting, yet powerful enterprise-like proof of concepts and demos. And all of this is just in a form factor of 80 by 100 mm. So very powerful. And you can buy it from a set of partners, retailers that are including, you know, Seed Studio, SparkFun, Amazon, and so on. So at the heart of Jetson Nano, we have what is called as the Jetson Nano Compute Module. And this is the onboard GPU, which is completely independent of the dev kit. So the dev kit empowers developers to basically develop, test, debug, and deploy AI models. But in production, you actually don't need to have the complete dev kit. The module is extremely tiny, and it can be separated from the dev kit and deployed in production environments. And it is going to be independent of the dev kit or you know, some of the other connectors that you need. So this is very small, very powerful, and is capable of running autonomously in environments where you don't need a dev board or a computer attached to it. So this is going to be $129. I think it's already available. This is going to be powering a lot of drones, autonomous vehicles, and many industrial automation use cases. So as I mentioned, I have already been playing with Jetson TX2. It's been slightly expensive, but it's been very powerful. But Jetson Nano brings the power of TX2. It's slightly toned down version, but for that form factor, it is still very powerful. So if you look at the Jetson family, Nano is the smallest. Then we have TX2. And then there is an industrial flavor of TX2, which is coming with 8 GB and 1.3 teraflops capability. And then there is a Jetson AGX Xavier. And this is more meant for autonomous vehicles, connected cars, and more industrial scenarios. But the advantage of using the Jetson family is the software layer that powers all these devices is exactly the same. It's very, very consistent. That means if you actually invest in learning Jetpack running on Jetson Nano, you can reuse your skills in any of these platforms. And not just that, it's also your gateway to CUDA and cuDNN and TensorRT, which you can actually apply in the public cloud or in your data center if you are actually running a GPU-backed infrastructure. So this is from AI at edge all the way to autonomous machines and powerful industrial automation scenarios. So what actually powers the Jetson family? As I mentioned, if you have ever programmed CUDA or if you have ever dealt with TensorFlow GPU or any of the GPU accelerated training or inferencing models, you know there are multiple layers that basically power the NVIDIA stack. So at the bottom of the stack, we have a GPU. It could be as simple, affordable GPU like a 1080 Ti or a 1050 Ti. I have two desktops that actually run 1080 Ti. So that is my most affordable environment to run deep learning models. And you can go all the way to the T4 or P100 or K80 family of GPUs. So that is going to be the physical GPU that you're going to attach to your computer. And then you definitely need a driver. And that driver is the NVIDIA device driver, which is typically used for your video cards and for your desktop performance and rendering and so on. So you still need that driver. So once you have the NVIDIA driver, you need something called CUDA. So CUDA is the programming interface for the underlying GPUs. So it basically gives you a mechanism, a programmable channel to talk to the underlying GPUs via the NVIDIA driver. Now, CUDA is very low level. Obviously, you got to be a system level programmer to deal with CUDA. But machine learning programmers, data scientists, and artificial intelligence engineers don't need to directly deal with CUDA. There is a layer on top of CUDA, and that is called cuDNN, which is another library which is purpose-built for machine learning and deep learning. And that is going to talk to the CUDA layer, and CUDA layer will talk to the rest of the GPU infrastructure, but cuDNN is the fundamental layer. And on top of cuDNN, you have a variety of Python and C++ libraries that make it extremely easy to deal with the GPUs. The best thing is you don't need to deal with any of the low-level primitives. Thanks to the integration with high-level frameworks like TensorFlow GPU and PyTorch Cafe, you can actually write programs that can take advantage of the NVIDIA GPU infrastructure at runtime. And that magic is enabled by the software layer powering the NVIDIA stack. Now, coming to Edge and the Jetson family, obviously we cannot have the same set of stack running at the edge. There are a lot of differences in terms of the form factor, the CPU power, the available power supply and so on. So to optimize it for that, NVIDIA has built a software layer called Jetpack. So Jetpack is a combination of multiple things. At the bottommost layer of Jetpack, we have a customized flavor of Ubuntu 18.04. The most recent version of Jetpack 4.2 comes with Ubuntu 18.04, and that has been built for the ARM64 architecture. And on top of that, you have a variety of things, you know, all the boxes that you see here from TensorRT, cuDNN, VisionWorks, OpenCV, and so on. They not only target the machine learning and deep learning scenarios, but also video rendering and some of the high performance computing use cases. So on top of the actual Jetpack SDK, we have very high level libraries that make it easy to ingest camera feeds and perform real-time inferencing, that is DeepStream SDK. And then to deal with ROS and robotics, there is an Isaac robotics engine. So these high-level SDKs use the underlying layers provided by Jetpack to actually make developers productive. So you don't need to deal with the low-level primitives, but you can use a high-level language like Python and still tap into the power of GPUs. So this is how the software stack is layered. More on that later. Now, coming to a variety of components that come with Jetpack. So the very first thing that you are going to do when you buy a Jetson Nano is to download an SD image, an SD card image from NVIDIA site and flash it on your SD card. So that actually comes with Jetpack. So Jetpack, don't mistake it for an SDK. It is actually an operating system powered by Ubuntu and comes with all the dependencies. What I actually enjoyed about Jetpack is it removes the pain of configuring the NVIDIA drivers, CUDA, cuDNN, and some of the other dependencies that you need to deal with on the desktop side. NVIDIA did a fantastic job of packaging Jetpack into an image file that can be directly flashed on an SD card and straight away boot your Jetson Nano, and you have a full-blown, fully configured environment to get started. You see a laundry list of packages. All of them are available out of the box. You don't need to do a single app get install after you actually boot your Nano for the first time. That is the advantage of using Jetpack. Now, In terms of machine learning and deep learning support, all the popular frameworks, you know, whether it is CAFE2 or Keras, PyTorch, MXNet, CNTK, TensorFlow, all of them can be optimized for the Jetpack environment. At the same time, the robotic automation capabilities, you know, available through Greengrass, MPI, ROS, and some of the other libraries, that's also available on top of the Jetson platform. So we are going to focus more on machine learning. So let's take a closer look at it. Now, if you're not very familiar with deep learning, basically deep learning models have two lives, two independent lives. The first life of a deep learning model is training. So this is where the data scientists, ML engineers spend a lot of time developing the model, training it for precision and accuracy, and making sure that it is performing the way they want it. And it is typically done on a distributed cluster in the public cloud or on purpose-built machines like DGX. But that is one side of the story. That is the first life of the deep learning model, where it is actually getting trained. And the data scientist, ML engineer can choose a language of their choice. Normally, it is always Python, but sometimes it is going to be C++ or R. But it's Python, which is the most popular one. And once the language is decided, they choose one of the frameworks like TensorFlow, Keras, MXNet, or PyTorch. And the training gets done. Now the model is fully trained and it is ready to be deployed in production. And that's where the second life of the deep learning model starts. And that is basically called as inferencing. Now in inferencing, you basically send unknown production data to a model and it either classifies or detects or predicts based on the input. And this model is going to run like a microservice on top of a Kubernetes cluster, or it is going to be deployed at an edge device on an edge computing layer, living very far off. Maybe it is deployed inside a vessel in a ship somewhere in the Pacific Ocean, or it could be deployed in an extremely remote location, which is very hard to reach, maybe a pretty tall, large windmill. But the model actually goes and lives there to perform inferencing in real time. That is the second life of the deep learning model. Now, between training and inferencing, there needs to be one more step, which is an optimization process. Now, unfortunately, the model that is meant to be deployed, you know, straight from the training environment is not highly optimized for the edge environments, because these models are trained on full-blown GPUs that have a lot of horsepower, and those models are pretty large, and they are not really optimized to run in slightly constrained environments powered by edge devices. So what you need to do is basically take a fully trained model from one of the frameworks and then optimize it for your target environment. Now, this optimization is very important because without losing the accuracy, it is going to fine-tune and make the model ready for inferencing at the edge. So that process is actually called as the intermediary graph or optimization graph. So in NVIDIA's environment, the runtime responsible for inferencing is called TensorRT. So TensorRT is a highly fine-tuned, highly optimized environment to run models for inferencing. So before you could actually run a TensorFlow model at the edge, what you need to do is convert that into a TensorRT compatible graph. And that is what is happening here. So we take a TensorFlow model, we turn that into a TFTRT, which is the TensorFlow tensor runtime graph, and then we run it through an optimization process. And this is going to make sure that we are not losing the accuracy, but with some reduced precision, we are going to get to the same results. It does some data type conversion. For example, most of the data types that are used at inferencing will be based on int8 or FP16, the floating point data type. And it is going to make sure that it is not missing out on the actual accuracy, but it is ready to be run at the edge. So after that, it actually goes into production, and the model is going to be used for inferencing. And when there is a drift, what I mean by drift is when the predictions are not very accurate, The public cloud environment is again used for training. A new model gets generated. It goes through this pipeline of export, optimize, and then all the way to the deployment. So on the deployment, it is TensorRT, and on the for inferencing, and on the training side, it could be any of the frameworks like TensorFlow, Caffe, Keras, and so on. Now, coming to the system setup. By the way, I'm going to walk you through a demo on TensorRT, so stay tuned. So system setup. There are a lot of guides. In fact, NVIDIA has fantastic videos and self-paced guides to walk you through to get started with NVIDIA Jetson Nano. But a couple of best practices. The first thing is don't use micro USB for power. It is just not enough. It doesn't give enough juice to the GPU and the cameras that are going to connect. So invest in a good external power supply. The most recommended one is from Adafruit that comes with 5 volt, 4 amps rating. Don't compromise on that. Get that as your external power supply. And then you need to basically modify some settings, like you need to insert a jumper plug to make sure that the power is coming via the power barrel and external power supply and not the inbuilt micro USB. That is the first step. Second step, don't settle for anything less than 32 GB of SD card, class 10, because we are going to run swap memory on the same card. We are going to download a ton of models. We are going to install a lot of software, and all of them are very heavy. And each model runs into a few gigabytes. So you definitely need more storage. So don't compromise. Don't settle for anything less than 32 GB SD card, preferably class 10, which will give you better throughput. Those are the two important things. And if you're compromising on it, you may not even get optimal performance. You cannot really go far without this setup. So the best way to get started with Jetson Nano is to clone this repo, github.com/dustynvjetsoninference. It has ton of resources. It has a self-paced guide. And if you have been following my series, I ran a webinar on NVIDIA digits where we classified multiple breeds of dogs. So the beauty is you can actually train a model with NVIDIA digits, which is completely serverless, which is completely codeless. Take that model, run it through a TensorRT optimization, and then deploy it on Jetson Nano. And this URL actually has a step-by-step guide to train a model using NVIDIA digits in the public cloud, but deploy that on Jetson Nano. So I highly recommend that you get started with this GitHub repo and go through the self-paced study guide that's available there. So enough of theory. I'm pretty excited to walk you through a couple of demos. But again, I want to highlight, if you are owning a Jetson Nano, the arrow that you see here is the jumper setting. It is the J48. You need to plug that to make sure that the power is coming from the barrel and not the micro USB. So this picture is from my live setup. So I'm actually using an external power supply and I'm running at maximum clock speed with a swap memory enabled, and it is giving pretty good performance. So let me walk you through the demo. So what do I have here? Well, so here is my Jetson Nano environment. I have already SSH'd into it. I can actually show you. So I can SSH into it. It is running the standard Ubuntu. So it has kernel 4.9. And if you are familiar with Ubuntu, you can use most of the commands. Now, if you have been programming GPUs, you know, there are certain first steps that you actually do, right? So if you are installing CUDA all by yourself, how do you ensure that your setup is correct? You run a couple of commands. The first one is you actually run what is called NVIDIA SMI, and that is going to confirm that the NVIDIA driver is in place. The next thing that you're going to run is actually called a command, which is device query. So device query will tell you everything about the GPU that's currently installed. Now, the same device query command you would run on a desktop or a server or a public cloud VM, you can run it in Jetson Nano, and it confirms that it is actually running one CUDA-capable GPU device. And this is a great joy to see, because to get this far in a typical setup, you need to spend a lot of time. It's a lot of sweat and blood to get to this point if you're building up everything by yourself. But you know, when you install Jetson Nano with Jetpack SDK, you can actually come to this directory, build this sample, and run device query. The other thing that is very common is checking the bandwidth. So there is a command called bandwidth test. You need to build them before you can execute. I have already done that to save time. So this is going to tell us, you know, how performant is the GPU and how long it takes to basically get the data in and out. So this is the bandwidth test, and both of them have passed with flying colors, and that's an indication that we have the CUDA environment already set up. So the next thing is, can we access this GPU from TensorFlow? Absolutely. So let me run a command which will give us the TensorFlow point of view of the GPU. So now I'm actually executing this Python script, and this is going to show us a lot of verbose data. And the most interesting part is this. The last section of this output is device GPU zero, and this is a confirmation that TensorFlow is able to access the underlying GPU. So the code for this is pretty simple. It is just a couple of Python statements. So we import device lib and we list all the local devices. It basically lists down all the CPUs and GPUs and the cores that are attached to this. And this is an indication that the GPU is indeed accessible from TensorFlow. So one point to understand, you don't need just TensorRT to run inferencing. You can actually do training on Jetson Nano, albeit what is called as the transfer learning. You cannot do full-blown training from the ground up. Like you cannot actually write a fully connected layer and create a convolutional neural network and train it end to end, but you can pick up an existing neural network architecture like ResNet or GoogleNet or AlexNet, use it as a starting point and perform what is called as transfer learning. You can do that with TensorFlow or PyTorch, and that is called on-device training, which is pretty powerful. In environments where you don't have the luxury of training in the public cloud, you can actually do it on the device at the edge, and that is the power of transfer learning. So now it is actually confirmed that we are indeed talking to GPU backend. The other thing is there is a version of Docker that is available on Jetson Nano. So when you actually run Docker version, it actually tells us that it is running the 1809 version of Docker engine. This is again very powerful. The only thing to understand is this is not an x86 Docker engine. It is an ARM64 one. That means you can only run images that are optimized for ARM64. I was very tempted to check if I can run things like digits, which will expect NVIDIA Docker runtime. At the time of testing, it was not available, but just 2 days ago, NVIDIA has published a beta of NVIDIA Docker that runs on Jetson, which means if you're familiar with the NVIDIA Docker runtime and you have been playing with it in the public cloud environments, you can pretty much run that on Jetson Nano, and you can pull NVIDIA Docker compatible images from NVIDIA GPU cloud, and that gives you access to a plethora of software which is going to be running at the edge. So it's a very, very powerful step where you can actually run NVIDIA Docker compatible images at the edge. But for now, you can still access GPU before NVIDIA Docker becomes generally available. All you got to do is run the Docker image by passing a set of parameters. So if you actually look at the script here, I'm passing multiple nvhost parameters, and all of them will make the GPU visible to the code running inside the container. So we are going to run the device query within the container. So let's go ahead and run this, and you will see the familiar device query command. But the difference between the previous one and this is actually run inside the container. And trust me, this is super powerful because this just opens up doors to running a variety of custom modules, and it also makes it very powerful to run public cloud-based IoT edge platforms like Azure IoT Edge, AWS Greengrass, and so on. The moment you have the support for containers and containers can talk to the GPU, you can do a ton of stuff. For example, you can actually have a deep learning model packaged inside the container that can talk to the processor, that can talk to the GPU, and you can run that container for inferencing, and you can automatically push newer versions with very little friction. So this is again a fantastic step from NVIDIA to make Docker available on Jetson. Then there is another repository that you can clone, which is called Jetson Reference. It's available on the same URL that I have shown. And this comes with a lot of samples. So again, I have gone ahead and built this. It downloads more than a dozen models, multiple versions of it, and you can actually run them from the command line or from the live camera. For example, this is going to take a fruit image as an input, and it is going to label it and spit out the output. And this is going to take advantage of the GPU. So when we actually run this, you'll notice that it is using TensorRT version 5.06, and it is taking advantage of the GPU to optimize the cafe model graph, and it is going to generate a new image. I'm not going to show you this. You can actually go to the GitHub repo and take a look at the image output. It basically, it will put a label on the input image. So the first time you're running this, it's going to take slightly longer because the model is going to be loaded in the memory and inside the GPU, and it is also going through the optimization process. But the more often you run, or if you actually load the model and keep it running, the inferencing is going to be super fast. So this is actually an example of how we take a static image and then pass it through a TensorRT optimized model and emit the image with a label. You can also do this with the camera, but I'm going to show that demo in the next webinar. Now, the other thing that I want to show you is how do we convert a TensorFlow model to a TensorRT? Now, starting with, I think, TensorFlow 1.12, Google has started supporting TensorRT as a native library, as a native module within TensorFlow. So what it basically gives is a very simplified workflow where you first train the model, you generate the checkpoint or the protobuf file, and then you call another method to essentially convert the protobuf file from classic TensorFlow into a TensorFlow TRT model, which is the TensorRT model, and then pass it on to the NVIDIA layer for inferencing. So that workflow simplifies a lot of things. And I want to show you a quick demo of this. Again, I'm not going to run all the cells. This has been cached. It's currently in warm mode because some of these steps would take a longer time to load the graph and so on. But you know, we basically import the TensorFlow libraries. The most interesting thing is the TensorFlow contrib.tensorRT module. And then NVIDIA comes with some helper modules for classification and object detection. I'm also taking advantage of that. Then we are downloading this model called Inception V1. So we are going to download the checkpoint file, and the labels are coming from the same model. And then we pick up an image, which is dog yawning. And then we first download the model, and then we build the frozen graph. We are not training here. We are actually picking up a pre-trained model based on Inception. So we take the graph that is on the disk, and then the frozen graph is passed on to TensorRT for optimizing it for inferencing. And all of this is within the TensorFlow environment and workflow. So now we actually take the frozen graph, which is representing the Inception neural network architecture, and we pass it on to this method, which is create inference graph. And what it basically does is to emit another model, another binary, which is highly optimized for TensorRT. And then we pick up the TensorRT model and not the original TensorFlow Inception model, and pass it through the initial session, and then use that session to basically load an image. So we are now loading this image, and this is a dog yawning. So now what we're going to do is take this image and pass it on to the TensorRT model, which is going to perform classification. So now we actually run this through the TensorRT model. And again, this is fast because I've been running this notebook in the background. So now once the image has passed through the TensorRT model, we can go ahead and grab all the labels. And obviously, the highest score is given to golden retriever, and it is not a surprise. If you like dogs like me, you actually appreciate that, this model has been pretty accurate in detecting that, the dog breed is a golden retriever. So that is how fast you can actually perform inferencing. You can also turn this into a live camera demo where you can actually flash objects and it can be detected. But as I said, that requires some additional work and integration with OpenCV, which I'm currently working on. So stay tuned for another webinar where I'll walk you through object detection and classification in real time with TensorRT. So this is the quick walkthrough of what is Jetson Nano, what to expect from it, what software is bundled, and what can you do with it. As I mentioned earlier, this is in the series where I'm talking about AI at edge, and I'm going to do more of these sessions in the future. My plan is to cover a deep dive on converting TensorFlow models to TensorRT, and do one more session on PyTorch to TensorRT, followed by transfer learning at the edge, and then maybe I'll figure out a few more additional scenarios that are exciting, and I'm going to bring all of them to you. So I hope you found this useful. I want to summarize what we have discussed so far. Jetson Nano brings an affordable GPU to the edge. It can't get cheaper than this, $99, extremely affordable, powered by a GPU. Optimize it for mainstream deep learning frameworks, TensorFlow, PyTorch, MXNet, CNPK, Caffe, you name it, it is supported. Jetpack contains the essential software stack to talk to the underlying GPU infrastructure. TensorRT is the optimized inferencing engine to run models trained in mainstream toolkits and frameworks. Supports USB and camera serial interface for connecting multiple camera modules. You can go up to 4 on board, and you can have additional USB and IP cameras. My recommendation is to get familiar with NVIDIA Digits, which is a codeless training environment, and start from there to figure out how you can optimize models for TensorRT for inferencing. So that brings us to the end. I want to thank our sponsors. I am, again, very happy to see Google Cloud on the sponsorship list. The New Stack, our media partner where all the content goes live. Every session will have one or two articles that will help you get started and literally copy and paste the code that I'm showing you here. So everything that you have seen is going to be made available at the New Stack in the form of an article or a tutorial. Foghorn, a Bay Area-based edge computing company that is targeting multi-cloud integration with industrial automation and industrial edge computing. Portworks, a container native storage company, again in Bay Area. I want to thank our sponsors for supporting me in this initiative. And I want to announce the next session on July 25th, where I'm going to bring you the infrastructure side of things, and I'm going to do a deep dive on authentication and authorization in Kubernetes. This is going to be pretty interesting if you have ever wanted to understand the difference between ABAC, RBAC, and how do you use service accounts, and how do you create roles, how do you secure your namespaces and deployments. Stay tuned for this session. I'm going to bring you everything about authentication and authorization in Kubernetes. So with that, I want to bring up a quick poll. All right, so how relevant was the webinar content for you? Brilliant. So thank you for that. I really appreciate your feedback. And finally, how do you rate the overall quality of the webinar? This includes everything from AV quality to my presentation skills, my slides, the quality of demos, basically the whole experience. All right. So most of you felt it is excellent and really good. So thank you so much for that. This will encourage me to do more and deliver more sessions in the future. So let me see if there are any questions. So I have a standard question that comes up in almost every webinar. Is this session recorded? Absolutely. You're going to get an email in a couple of days with the link to the recording. The slide deck is going to be made available, and the entire content, literally the transcription of this session, is going to be published at the news stack tomorrow. A combination of my previous article and what's coming up tomorrow will basically complete everything that I have talked to you about. So do keep an eye at the news stack for this article. So that brings us to the end of this session. Stay tuned for MI2 webinars, where I bring you everything about machine intelligence and modern infrastructure. Thanks again for attending. I will see you in the next webinar.